Hello, everyone, and thanks for tuning into Conversations with INDIAai, our leadership podcast series, where we give you a glimpse into the workings of successful tech leaders, their eureka moments, their tribulations, and so much more. In today's episode, we have two very special guests with us, Mr. Abhishek Singh, who's the president and CEO of NeGD, and Mr. Arvind Pani, who's the co-founder of Reverie Technologies, who will be in conversation with me on a subject that is all-pervasive and deeply important to India's vision to become a tech visionary and a leader in AI. We're going to be talking about the role of technologies like AI in furthering regional language inclusivity, especially right now as India battles COVID-19 and healthcare systems are at a stretch. As president and CEO of NeGD and MD CEO of Digital India Corporation, Abhishek Singh is at the core of policy formulation for the Union government on the use of technology to improve governance. Meanwhile, Arvind Pani is currently living his childhood dream of being an entrepreneur, and that too with his brother Vivekanand. Together, the duo are attempting to solve a highly critical issue for Digital India, which is essentially to make Indian internet more inclusive with more opportunity for all Indians, regardless of the language they speak. Welcome, Mr. Singh and Mr. Pani, to today's conversation with INDIAai.
Thank you, Sindhija.
Thank you.
Abhishek ji, very nice to see you as well virtually.
Yeah, same here, Arvind. We have been talking to each other and hearing about each other's work, but yes, good to meet you virtually.
Thank you so much.
So first off, I'd like to start with you, Mr. Singh. It'd be great if you could tell us a little bit about why the proliferation of regional language technologies is so critical to enhance the reach of education in India.
See, like if you look at the internet and look at the growth of internet and the content that is available virtually around, most of it is in English, and a lot of it is now increasingly being available in Hindi and other regional languages. So like to provide access to information is one of the goals that we have. And in order to empower citizens, this is very important that everybody gets access to internet and access to content in the language that they understand. And when we come to education, if you look at the new education policy also, it gives a lot of focus on learning in mother tongue. And especially if you look at the present times when the learning has gone online and a lot of content is available, if we do not have content available in regional languages and Hindi along with English, then we are actually creating a different kind of digital haves and have-nots, not in the point of having connectivity, but even if you have the connectivity, if the content is not there, then a child who is studying in English medium school has access to more content and more information vis-a-vis a child who is studying in his mother tongue. So this has to be broken down, and it has been proved in several studies that studying in mother tongue in the initial years of a child is really, really beneficial. So this is one of the objectives because of which the new education policy focuses a lot of attention on education, pedagogy in mother tongue, and internet and digital technologies has to kind of meet that challenge that is there, the gap that exists. So this requires, of course, a lot of investments, a lot of effort in trying to use freely available technologies to ensure content is available, is accessible. So that's the prime reason because of which ensuring that sufficient amount of content is available in regional languages becomes a top priority for the government.
Absolutely. I think that is a primary concern right now in terms of trying to ensure that all of India is very equally connected. And it's not just about, like you said, just establishing connectivity alone through phones and, through smart devices. So Arvind, on to you. Can you elaborate how, for instance, at a time like this, how regional language inclusivity really took center stage during the pandemic when communication across the spectrum was so critical?
So it is still fresh in my mind. March of 2020, when this entire COVID, we were hearing about COVID in the news in China, but then March of 2020 is when it came home to India. Yeah. And there was a nationwide lockdown. Then there was a need for the information to really reach, credible information that people can rely on, to reach every nook and corner of the country. And digital was the most dominant medium to be able to do that. Now, that was the time when we realized, when I say we, that means as a country, that you really can't be communicating and reaching information to everybody in India only relying on English language. And if we all go back and remember those times, one of the most important source of information that the country was looking forward to was the address that our prime minister used to make. And that was all in Hindi. So we had taken an initiative So Hindi is still about 40% of India's population. So we took an initiative that we took those videos and we actually converted those on the video itself. We had voiceover in multiple languages and we circulated that within communities, and that was very well received. Right? So that is one of the things that I remember. The other thing that I remember is, of course, Mr. Abhishek Singh is here. There are two initiatives that we have done where he has been, he has, one is that he has led it, like the MyGov website, COVID website has been in 10 languages, and that has been done using our platform. And the second initiative that I would like to mention about is the telemedicine helpline. So there are a bunch of entrepreneurs who came together that how could we make a difference? How could we make an impact during this time? And telemedicine helpline is something that they thought they would set up in all the states. So telemedicine helpline in different states, again, needed to be in at least three languages, English, Hindi, and the native language of that particular state.
Right.
So the process that was adopted during the initial days was very cumbersome. A very small script of telemedicine, it has to be recorded in the studio by a voiceover artist. That usually took about 48 hours to 72 hours. So using our technologies, the voice technologies that we have, we in fact made those scripts available, the helpline scripts available for IVR usage in fact less than 2 to 3 hours. So that's how we reduced that. So this was like information reaching and help available to people in their languages was extremely important in the midst of the pandemic. The other thing also that has happened is that because of this pandemic, the realization that digital as a channel is so important, and therefore for making digital inclusive, you also have to have languages in that. So these are two most important realizations that have happened during the pandemic.
Most definitely. So here's a question I think which I think both of you are very poised to answer. So I'll start with you, Mr. Singh. So voice technology really is gaining momentum. I think it was very evident from what Mr. Pani just spoke about. So how will this really impact the development of regional languages, and how can this movement really be taken to the next line of digital adopters in India, like next billion users?
See, right now in India we have almost 500 to 600 million internet users. But if you have to really ensure that the next 500 million people get on to the internet and get on to be able to use it, we'll have to go beyond the traditional modes of access to internet. And this will primarily be, number one, of course, in regional languages, because not everyone is able to converse in English or Hindi or the top languages. And the next important thing will be voice, because voice becomes very simple to interact. And there is no reason, just like we talk to the devices that we have, the smart devices, whether the Alexas or the Siris or the Google Assistants, and ask people, ask questions, and we get the answers. Mm-hmm. The similar interface is going to come for accessing public services. And I must mention that initiative that we have driven, and within the next 3 to 6 months, I hope we'll be seeing it live on the Umang platform. Umang is the super app that we have, which brings together services from multiple government departments. So what it does is that right now we have almost 20,000 services, which includes 1,200 government and state services and remaining bill payment services. But to navigate on that, still you require some basic level of skill to find out what service you are looking at, even though it's AI enabled and intuitive. But still, it's not that easy for a person to use that. So for any person who is not IT literate, for them, if the voice interface that we are building on the Umang platform, that will make the services more accessible. So like, for example, you want to search for blood groups, which is available on the eRaktkosh app on Umang platform. Mm-hmm. You could talk to the Umang app and say that, hey, Umang, where do I find my B-positive blood group? Yeah, Umang app, B-positive blood group, kaha milega? You're in any language. Umang is available in 12, 13 languages. So the plan is that in 3 to 6 months, maybe around 50 services on Umang will be available with a voice interface. And then it will be interactive, conversational, AI, voice-driven, which will keep on responding based on your inputs. It will read and give you the answer. It will open the app. If you want to track your passport status, if you want to track the PAN number or driving license, whatever services are available, or get information from the IMD app on Umang, all of it will be available very easily with that voice interface. So that would help in a greater adoption for these services. And similarly, for various kinds of people who are visually challenged or who are not able to access the internet like we do, similar such services will come on other government portals also. So once that happens, I feel that the number of people who will be using e-services will grow up exponentially. And then we will see a lot of new services, new startups who will offer value-added services on top of that. Because once this whole platform is available, which is offering conversational AI services or chatbot or what voice bot services, then many other services will be there. You will be able to find, book railway tickets, you will be able to book COVID vaccination appointments with a voice interface rather than trying to navigate, which many people struggle. And it would ultimately be a better user experience. So this is what voice internet is going to do. And I'm sure once it happens, the demand from citizens for more and more services to be available on that interface will grow exponentially. And then it will be more of a challenge to government departments to ensure that we have the wherewithal, we have the technical capacity, we have the partnership with the service providers to be able to meet that demand. But yes, it will be a game changer, especially in a country like India, where a lot many people are still not illiterate and would love to use voice as a medium for interacting with the government and interacting for public services as also other services.
Yeah, makes sense. So, Mr. Pani, I think Mr. Singh has already given like a host of very interesting use cases for you to really sort of deploy and develop on. So any thoughts on how actually this can be implemented?
Yeah, so first of all, I completely agree with what Mr. Singh just mentioned. I would just like to augment a few things in addition to what he has spoken. See, India is demographically, it's a very interesting and unique country. Okay, we all know about that. Yeah. Apart from the diversity of languages which are there, right? Now, we are talking about inclusion, making the entire digital or internet inclusive. So language becomes one of those, right? Now, we have been talking about language barrier, but what is not so often spoken about is also the literacy barrier, right? Which is what Mr. Singh also touched upon. Now, when you have something which is text-based, you are in a way addressing the language barrier for people who are literate, right? But there is also a large part of Indian population that is that likes to converse in their language. For example, they understand, they speak that language, but they don't necessarily are capable of reading and writing in that language. So which is where voice is an additional dimension. In addition to whatever is there, the capabilities are there on the internet that makes it a lot more inclusive. Now, having said that, one of the myths that we keep hearing is that India is a voice-only country, which is actually not true. There is nothing called voice-only. So voice is another channel of engaging users, and that augments the already existing channels. I will give an example to be able to mention to state what I just mentioned.
Sure.
Now, if you take, let's say, if a user is using the internet to buy something, right? Or for that matter, there is no country where we can say that even in advanced countries where voice technology has matured, that text can be completely, you can completely eliminate text and rely only on voice technology, right? So coming to the example that I was mentioning here is if someone wants to buy something using voice in e-commerce, let's say I have a query, say, mujhe joota kharidna hai. Now, if I make a search like that, it's likely that it will throw up about 500 or 1,000 results of shoes, or for that matter, if I want to buy apparel. Now, it is not possible for the system to really read out all those 500,000 options back to me. And then I make a mental map of what those are and then go back and say that, okay, mujhe ab iske bare mein bolo. So that's a very cumbersome process. Whereas it becomes much easier when we are able to query in a voice. And if there are multiple options, those show up in a combination of images and text for us to make a selection and go forward. So that's why I said that these are complementary technologies that will make the entire experience much richer and therefore a lot more inclusive.
Okay. So while you're on that topic, it'd be great if you could just stress upon the challenges that really one faces while increasing adoption levels and enhancing the caliber of research in regional language technology development. It's a new area, it's a new domain, very few players are here. So how do you think these gaps can be addressed?
See, one of the major gaps which is there, I would say, is how we are thinking about the design itself. Okay, so far, unfortunately, our Indian internet, and it was in tune of with those times, because anybody who could access the internet at that time when internet came definitely knew English. So unfortunately, our internet got built in English. Okay, yeah. We never thought about internet should be there in other languages as well when it came into India. But now is a time when we have already reached a point where the number of users who are capable of using the internet in their languages, or who would prefer to use the internet in their languages, has far exceeded the people who understand English. So I think it is time for us to really step back a bit and see what does a real design for India mean. And what I mean by that is that let's for a moment exclude or assume that there is no one in India who talks or understands English. Let's design any digital property that we are doing for people ground up, keeping in mind that they don't understand English, they understand Indian languages. If we are able to successfully make such kind of a design, automatically we will make the internet inclusive for English language users. But the vice versa is not true. What we have been trying to do so far is that we are trying to make a lot many things usable for English users and trying to adapt those for Indian languages, right? So that is not helping. And I'm just trying to give a very simple analogy for everyone to understand. Now, if we go to a bank's branch, or if we go to a shop, okay, in our local community, we don't go there with an inherent assumption that if I know only English, then I will be able to go and make a transaction there. I can talk to people there. I can comfortably go inside and talk in my language, right? I can do banking in a branch by talking to a customer service representative in that language, and I can get my job done. But unfortunately, the same bank, when it comes to internet, there is a tag that, okay, if you don't know English, then you are not welcome to bank with me. If you don't know English, then you are not welcome to shop in my digital shop. So these are some of the things that are creating subconscious mental barriers among people. That is why our internet adoption is also limited to really very low friction kind of usage, where people are continuing to listen to music, watching videos, pictures. So if you have to take it to a next level, the serious usage is there. Like Mr. Singh was talking about accessing government services and interacting, right? So those kind of things will require the entire experience to change to a different level, where there is no dependency on English language at all. And one of the things that, and because Mr. Singh is there, I would like to also take this opportunity to mention. So almost everybody in India has an Aadhaar card, right? Yeah. Why can't we think of an initiative where my language preference of communication is linked to my Aadhaar card, and that is opened up as an API for anybody. So let's say a bank, right? A bank wants to bank with me from my Aadhaar, my identity. They would be able to know in which language I want to communicate, right? And once bank knows that, then the moment I try to open the website of the bank, or I open the app, or I dial IVR, it should all start in my language instead of starting in English, then giving me an option to go into that language. So these are some of the barriers that I would say that we should consciously work towards breaking.
That's actually a very interesting idea that you put forth. Let's hope that someone can take it up on that and as a priority. And finally, Mr. Singh, this year I think was a landmark year as far as language translation was concerned, which because of the launch of the National Language Translation Mission. So, how is the NLTM really poised to empower the next billion internet users in India? What are the plans that entail in making this a reality?
See, the NLTM has been planned with a vision to achieve almost all that Arvind was mentioning, and the entire wish list of what we need to do to create a digital breakthrough in enabling communications, in enabling internet in regional languages and voice-enabled internet. Because as he mentioned the examples of shopping and buying shoes and other things. But similarly, think of something like telemedicine. Mm-hmm. For e-Sanjeevani, for example, we are saying that e-Sanjeevani is there. But when you talk to a doctor, when a common man goes there, he should be able to talk in his native language. But how do you do that? When you start cracking the technology piece of it, you realize that there are a lot of players involved in the whole thing. Reverie and Arvind, they have built up a beautiful solution. There are other startups who are working in this space. People are building multiple solutions. And it's not that there's such kind of initiative under the National Language Translation Mission can be done by government itself or can be done only by startups or private sector. It has to be a conjoined effort. And what the government is planning to do as part of the National Language Translation Mission is to provide a platform wherein all the tool sets that are required, all the data sets that are required, because again, to build a good voice-enabled or language-enabled engine, you would require a lot of data. And who has the maximum amount of data? Government has that. So if we can use that data and provide that in easy to use data sets for people to use, that can really transform the way the NLTM can be implemented. So as part of the NLTM, three key initiatives have been taken up, which will be primarily to get data sets from all over India, which are innovatively titled as Padho India, Likho India, and Padho India, Likho India, and Suno India. So that way, it will be like, for Suno India, there will be like something that will, a voice clip will play on. And then you have to say what it means. Because many people read it differently. Many people hear it differently. If you look at, say, for example, a language like Gujarati, the way Gujarati is spoken in the north of Gujarat and the south of Gujarat varies. Even in smaller states, like I have worked for a long time in Nagaland, where there are a lot of tribal languages, where in the language, there are nuances which varies. So the same language can have different forms of variation. So in order to build a true AI engine, which facilitates seamless and real-time language translations or makes gives right hints and about what it means, you need all these data sets from all over India. So this will be a crowdsourcing exercise in which these data sets will be collected and then they will be analyzed by the engine and then it will be made publicly available. Similarly, there were a lot of other tools will be which will be developed by government will be made publicly available as part of the National Language Translation Mission for startups and entrepreneurs to build solutions on top of it. So if anybody wants to use that, to build that into their website, this data that is there will be available. So not every company, not every bank which wants to offer banking services in Indian languages or voice-enabled, they need not bother about building this or training this engine. So this entire central piece will be developed as part of the National Language Translation Mission. It will be available for the whole ecosystem. And people will be able to free to contribute that and take and benefit from what is being built there. So that's the whole ecosystem that is being planned. And it will be a big national digital public platform. It will be like a common artifact like the Aadhaar or the UPI, which has transformed, say, the identity solution or the payment solution. Simply for translation, this whole platform will enable this free and open exchange of information and allow people to adopt to building web solutions or app solutions or voice solutions in the native languages. So this is what the National Language Translation Mission aims to do. But there's a lot of work to do, but the way it has been architected and the opening slide of the presentation that I saw last week of the whole NLTM, it says that it's not that you have to play the music yourself. You have to be the government has to ensure that the orchestra performs. There will be multiple players playing multiple instruments, building different solutions for different languages, and the government will play the role of the orchestra master who ensures that the good symphony is created and we are able to move on to enabling more and more e-services in multiple languages.
That sounds like a very, very musically inclined plan, but I really hope it all comes together and it will be like a very, seamless, effortless sort of way to sort of get all the digital users of India together on one platform. Thank you so much, both of you, for tuning in. And thanks everyone for listening into this particular episode. You can follow all our updates on our website and social channels. We'll be back very soon with another exciting story. Until then, stay safe and stay connected.